worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise is to our God. I don't care how you're feeling right now. Sing hallelujah to our God. Call me hallelujah. Every praise, every praise is to our God. Hey, this is what I love. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is.
God my Savior.
God my Savior.
God my healer.
God my healer.
God my deliverer.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
God my Savior.
God.
Well, good morning, EBC family, friends, and online guests. We welcome you once again to our online virtual church. We are so excited that you took the time to join us for another Sunday, and we just want to say thank you once again, and we just want to give you some big virtue hugs today to let you know we appreciate you for joining us online today. So our call to worship today is taken from Psalm 34, and it says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him. I know someone needs to hear the Lord's voice today, and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. This is no want to those who fear him. The young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing. So God, today I just thank you, God, that because we are your children, we don't lack anything, oh God. I thank you, God, today that great is thy faithfulness. New mercies we see every day. All that we ever need, oh God, you have already provided, oh God. And we are so honored today. And God, it's because you live, God. It's because you live, God. We can face tomorrow, God. I thank you, God, that you walk with us and you talk with us, oh God, in this season of this pandemic, oh God. Even though, God, we may be concerned about what's going on, God, but I thank God that you were not surprised by this. So we come today just saying, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you live in us, God. You walk with us, God. You talk with us. And more importantly, God, you love us. And for this, we give you thanks. We give you thanks. And you said that we will fear nothing. So in this season, we put all our fears at your feet. We put all our cares at your feet, oh. And we know, God, that you will hold us up with your right hand. So today, we are honored. We are privileged to say, great is thy faithfulness. You have been so faithful to us in this season. Oh, Lord, we can't even ask for more because, God, you have given us so much more. You have provided for us over and above, oh, God. And so we honor you, and we just say thank you once again. We thank you for this beautiful sanctuary. We thank you for the people that are about to gather, oh, God. And I just want to be mindful of those ones that are in a season of despair, that you are their hope. That anyone that's walking through a valley today in their grief, God, you are their comforter, oh God. And I thank you, God, today that you are still performing miracles. and you will continue to perform miracles. So we just pray for the families, oh God, in this season, that you will always be with them, that you will never leave nor forsake them. And as we come, God, we know who has the victory. You have the victory. And mighty are the works of your hands, God. You are about to do some mighty works in this season. And we thank you, God, because you live, we can face tomorrow, God. Because you live, God, all our fears are gone. Because, God, you live, we can face tomorrow. It's only because of you, God, we can say all fear is gone. So we thank you, God, today. We thank you, God, today for who you are in our lives. And we give you all the praise and glory in the Master's name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Yeah. We give you honor this morning. We give you glory this morning. Yeah. Sing, Lord, you're mighty.
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 Sing, Lord, you're mighty.
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 Sing, Lord, you're mighty.
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 One more time. Lord, you're mighty.
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 Lord, you're mighty. Oh, Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Hallelujah. You set your glory above the heavens and the earth. Yeah. When I think of all you made, the sun, the moon, and the stars. Yeah. No praise is high enough to express how great. Bow before the mighty God we serve.
time. What a mighty God we serve. Mighty God we serve. Heaven and earth adore the mighty God we serve. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
One more time, sing Savior.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
I want to take this time to thank you once again for partnering with our church and for your continued faithfulness. And as you will see on your screen, there we have three ways that you can give. And the first you can give through e-transfer, and the email is listed there. And secondly is through Canada Helps, which the website is also listed. And the third as well, you can send your offering in by mail, and the address is listed, 633 Parkwalk Road, Upper Hammonds Plains, B4B1N8. And if you like to drop your offering off, the office hours are Tuesdays and Thursdays between the hours of 9:30 a.m. and 12, where you can drop your offering off for safe drop-off. So right now, I'd just like to take this time to offer a prayer for just thanksgiving for this offering. So God, I just thank you once again for your faithfulness to this church and to the congregants, oh God, who continue to faithfully give. I thank you, God, that the seeds that are being planted through their tithes and offerings are being sown into good ground, oh God. And I thank you that we are just overflowing with so many blessings, oh God. So in this day, I just ask you, God, just to continue to be faithful to us, oh God, that we will always be a cheerful giver, oh God, and we will give with such a cheerful heart. And God, we know when we plant good seeds into your ground, God, you will give the increase. So again, God, we thank you. You continue to provide over and over and over again to us, oh God. And we can't even repay you, God, for what you did for us, oh God. So we thank you once again and continue to use the people that on the finance team, God, and the people that work behind the scenes to be wise stewards when it comes to using your money here on this earth. We thank you once again in the Master's name of Jesus. Amen.
Oh, the worshiper in me wants to be free from the cares of life that seem to weigh me down. Oh, the worshiper in me needs consistency to lift my hands and give you praise when no one's around. Oh, the worshiper in me wants to break free, yeah, from the intellectual mentality, yeah. Like when I should be up, I'm seated in my seat. I should be lifting my hands, giving you praise and glory. So I give you more. More, more, Lord, I give you more, more, more. I'm gonna sing that one more time. Oh, the worshiper in me wants to be free from the cares of life that seem to weigh me down, down. Oh, the worshiper in me needs consistency, yeah, to lift my hands and give you praise when no one's around, yeah. Oh, the worshiper in me wants to break free from the intellectual mentality, yeah. Like when I should be up, I'm seated in my seat. I should be lifting my hands, giving you praise and glory. Oh, Lord, Lord, I want to give my best to you. I want to do what you ask me to. I want to go wherever you stay. Say the word and I'll obey. I want to live a life that's real. I want to serve you, Lord, for real. Cause you deserve all this and more. Yeah. I want to give my best to you. I want to do what you ask me to. I want to go wherever you stay. Say the word and I'll obey. I want to live a life that's real. I want to serve you, Lord, for real. For you deserve have all this and more. So I give you more, every little thing, more, more. Lord, I give you more. Deserving of more, yeah, you're deserving of more, 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 yeah, you're deserving of more, you're deserving of more. Lord, I give you more, I give you more, you more, I give you more, I give you more of me, Lord, more of my time, more of my energy, more of my praise, Lord, I give you more, I give you more, I give you more, yeah, I give you more, I give you more. I wanna give my best to you. I want to do what you ask me to. I want to go wherever you stay. Say the word and I'll obey. I want to live a life that's real. I want to serve you, Lord, for real. Because you deserve all this and more. I'm going to sing that one more time. Listen. Lord, I want to give my best to you. I want to do what you ask me to. I want to go wherever you stay. Say the word and I'll obey. I want to live a life that's real. I want to serve you, Lord, for real. Because you deserve all this and more. So I give you more. More, more. Lord, I give you more, more, more.
Amen, amen. We give you more. God, we give you the rest of this service, God. Lord, if the worship team only knew how much this lines up with the word that is about to go forth, we give you more. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, worship team, for blessing us today. Well, church, before we go into the word this morning, I just want to let you know that as you have been hearing, online sign up will be going live next week. You can call or you can use the email link that's going to be going out for our service on September 13th. We are so excited to welcome you back. For those who are able to come back to service, all of our safety protocols are going to be in place. So look for that link online or you can call the office. Suzanne would love to sign you up as well. Please watch for it. The online sign up going live next week. You'll have a link that you can follow. Very easy to sign up for service September 13th, and we are so looking forward to it. Church, we are excited to be in this new series, I Am Radical, and I believe that God has a great word in store for us this morning. I'm going to jump right into the word. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 9, verse 22 to 26. Luke chapter 9, verse 22 to 26. If you have it, you can virtually say amen. Saying, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. And he said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, for him will the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in glory and the glory of the Father and the holy angels. This morning I want to preach on radical invitation. Radical invitation, come and die. come and die. Heavenly Father, I just ask right now, as we look at this word, God, a word that may appear heavy, but it is a radical invitation, one that comes out of love. So God, I ask right now that you would speak through me by the power of your Holy Spirit. God, that these words that go forth would not be my own, but yours. We thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Radical invitation, come and die. Jesus was very radical in this series, I Am Radical. We could have picked so many different portions of Scripture where Jesus said things that would be deemed radical. Things that he'd say, and we read them because they're in Scripture, and we're like, oh yeah, you know, take up your cross and follow me. It just seems like something that Jesus would say. He said things like, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Things that we read and we're like, that's pretty radical. That meant something. Even at that time, it meant something. When he would say, take up your cross and follow me, it would mean something. Jesus wasn't necessarily seeker sensitive. Sometimes it seemed like Jesus was actually trying to convince people not to follow him. Not to follow. It doesn't make any sense. But he would say things like that because he wanted people to know what the commitment to following Jesus would mean. Now, have you ever received an invitation before to a place that you did not want to go? Maybe you get those invitations all the time. Now, can I be honest with you for a moment? I might get myself in trouble for this. I receive invitations sometimes to weddings in the summer. If we got multiple wedding invitations, this would get my wife extremely excited. Now, unless I know the person personally, I'm not super excited to go to a wedding in the summer. How many weekends do we get in the summer and I'm going to be giving my Saturday away to go to a wedding? That's going to get me in trouble. But if I'm being honest, I don't want to give away my Saturday for a wedding invitation unless I know the people very, very well. Now, I can get excited for an invitation to a basketball game. That gets me excited. My cousin invited me for an all-expensive-paid fishing trip that I'm actually going to this weekend. That gets me excited. How about an invitation from Jesus when he says, come and die with me? That's the invitation. Come and die with me. Take up your cross and follow me. It is heavy stuff, but if we're being honest, we can't fully stomach or understand what he's asking us. When I told my wife that the title of my message was going to be Radical Invitation, Come and Die, she laughed. And she said, oh, you're serious. Come and die. Because I want us to get the picture of what Jesus was saying in this time, of how serious it was. Take up your cross and follow me. The phrase, a cross to bear, is a popular saying mirroring the words of Jesus when he said, take up your cross. Now, while the phrase is commonly understood to mean the acceptance of some burdensome task, oh, I've got this cross to bear, it is more than a symbol of the difficulties experienced by humanity. Any person, whether a follower of Jesus or not, is going to deal with frustration and pain in life. But taking up your cross and following Jesus is different from the cliched saying of a cross to bear. Because the cross was an instrument of death. The cross would end a person's life through suffocation, through loss of bodily fluids and multiple organ failure. The weight of the body pulling down the arms makes breathing extremely difficult. In addition, the hearts and lungs would stop working as blood would drain through the wounds. Crucifixion was invented by the Persians, and during Roman times, it was used as a punishment for the most serious of criminals. Someone nailed with their arms stretched out could expect to live at the longest for 24 hours. And I had far more details written out that I'm going to spare you of how painful crucifixion was for the person that would face it. Used as a torturous and painful experience for a criminal, it was the ultimate punishment. I remember an old song. I don't know if many of you guys will remember this man, but Ray Bolts, he used to sing this old song, Take Up Your Cross and Follow Jesus, and had this beautiful choir singing in the back, and they're kind of swaying, take up your cross, and they're swaying back and forth and follow Jesus. And I remember as a kid singing that song and looking back, not understanding what I'm singing. Take up your torture device and follow Jesus. And if I can be honest, I would say that many of those people in the beautiful choir may not have understood the weight of what they're singing either. Take up your cross and follow Jesus. What Jesus is referring to is complete commitment and obedience to him, even unto death. Obedience to the extreme measure and willingness to die in the pursuit of obedience. Death on a cross was not pleasant. It was painful, and beyond that, it was humiliating. The implication is that we need to follow Jesus even in seasons where it would be painful and maybe humiliating for us. And if I can be honest, there was a time in my life, I'm only 34 years old, but I remember a time even 15 years ago where if I told someone I was a pastor or I was planning to become a pastor, it was considered honorable and people were excited to hear that I was going into ministry. And now more and more people I talk to about it, it results in silence. Oh, you're one of those. Oh, that's cool. Okay, well, we'll talk about something else. Because the longer time goes on, as the world moves further and further away from Jesus Christ, the more difficult it will be for us to take up our cross and follow Jesus. This level of discipleship, it's weighty. But the amazing thing about Jesus is he was the ultimate leader. He never invites unless he equips. He never invites unless he equips. There's nothing worse than an invitation when there's no equipping. Have you ever been invited to help somebody move and you showed up and the boxes weren't packed? The truck wasn't showing up. And you're like, okay, I've made the decision. Listen, that may be a worse invitation than going to a wedding. I'll help you. If you're in our church and need help moving, give me a call. I would love to help you move because one day maybe I'll need help moving. But no one wants the invitation to help someone move. But when you show up and the boxes are not packed, the truck's not ready, we want to be equipped for the job that we're going to do. Maybe you volunteered at a function before and it was disorganized and the tools you needed to do what you needed to do were not there. Jesus never calls unless he equips. He never invites unless he's going to equip us, and he gives us the power of the Holy Spirit, because if we're being truthful, in my flesh, it is very difficult for me to take up my cross and follow Jesus. Acts 1, chapter 1, verse 8 says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, even to the remotest part of the earth. So when he's talking about taking up your cross, this is what he's talking about. This is what he's talking about, because Jesus is all about the gospel and the gospel moving forward. So if he's saying, take up your cross, it's because you're going to be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and you're going to need the power of the Holy Spirit. It's going to be sacrifice, but I promise I will go with you, I will equip you, I have given you everything you need. But when he invites us to take up our cross and follow him, the implication is that sometimes that's going to be difficult. Sometimes that's going to be difficult. He didn't say, you know, jump in the Hummer and follow Jesus. He said, take up your cross, because he knew it was going to be challenging. But you see, when the invitation is accepted, you realize something. You realize that the life that we've given up wasn't really worth keeping at all. The invitation to come and join with Jesus by carrying your cross results in your life, not your death. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And by saying, take up your cross and follow me, Jesus is giving us this picture of a concept of death to self. That you're dying, but you're not really dying, because in me you will live. He talks about, in that very same passage, he says, whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? And the idea is that nothing in this life is worth keeping if it means losing eternal life. Not a job, not a family, not a group of friends, not even our identity. Because until Christ is enough, nothing else will be. Until Christ is enough, nothing else will be. We'll pursue every single other thing. We'll look to fill that space with other things. And we'll say, if I can just get the next promotion, you know, maybe we need to grow our family a little bit more. If I need to add these friends to my friend group. But until Christ is enough, nothing else will be. And what you'll find is this, is that in all of those things, there is great joy when they're submitted to a life of following Jesus Christ. Now, this invitation wasn't just for spiritual elites. Now, you hear a message like this one, and maybe if you're a newer Christian, or maybe you're a Christian, you've been a Christian for a long time, but you don't consider yourself a serious Christian, which we can talk about that a little bit later. But there are no such thing as spiritual elites. When he says, take up your cross and follow me, it wasn't like saying, all those people who want to sign up for the board, it'd be great to take up your cross and follow me. He's talking to every single believer, mature believers, new believers, come and die. In Matthew 19, there's a rich man that asks Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus asks him to go sell all he has and give to the poor and follow him. And the man goes away sad because he acknowledges in his heart he cannot do it. He knows he can't do it. But here's the part that stings a little bit, is that many of us will look at Jesus' invitation and choose to be willing in some areas of our lives, but hold back in others. So, you know, Jesus, you can have this, and you can have this, and you can have this, but there are these little pieces that we want to grasp onto and hold onto. It's like, I can't give you that, Jesus. Sometimes these actually aren't even bad things, but they're things that we love having control over. Things that we love to have control over. And I've preached this before. I love to have control of my finances. I love to have control of my health. I love to have control of my time. So it's difficult to give those things over to Jesus because there's a little bit of fear of what he might do with those things. Oh, you're asking me to help this person out with my finances? We don't even have that much in the account. How can I help that person? Oh, you're asking me to give my time and do this? I need that for my family. This is family time. I can't go do that. And we're afraid that if we give all of these things over to Jesus, what might he ask of us? But what I've realized is this, is that there's no part way to die. If we're dying to self, we're dying to self. You don't die part way. If you take up your cross and follow Jesus, you don't take a hacksaw and pull off a little piece of the cross and say, okay, I can't quite carry the whole thing. I'm going to carry this piece, though. We say, God, you have my entire life. Every single thing that you're asking of me, whatever it is, I want to die with you in this. He's not looking for perfection. He just wants willing hearts. He just wants willing hearts. But do we understand the invitation? He doesn't expect instant perfection. He just asks for willing submission. He knows there's going to be times when you look back and say, you know what, God, I missed the mark in this area. I need to repent. He knows that those times are going to come. He knows that we're going to look back and have moments where we say, God, I thought that I should go this way, and I leaned more on my emotions than I did on the Holy Spirit. And I need to repent. He knows that, but he's not looking for instant perfection. He's asking for willing submission. So do we understand the invitation? The multitudes that followed Christ were convinced that he was going to bring a glorious kingdom to earth, freeing them from the oppressive Roman rule. Even his own disciples thought that way. Misunderstanding the prophecies, they were shocked when he started to talk about death to self and carrying the cross. People would leave him in droves because of this teaching. The religious people of that day could not understand what was going on because sometimes today we misunderstand the call of Jesus in the same way to one of health, wealth, and prosperity. The call of Jesus is a call to die. But today some will be unwilling to accept that call, leave him for a message that's more pleasant. Now, we had a whole movement and books written about this when we look at the prayer of Jabez. Now, I'm not bashing the prayer of Jabez. We probably have the prayer of Jabez books maybe even in this library. The prayer was, Lord, bless me and enlarge my territory. Was this prayer wrong? No, God actually grants his request. But I bring this up because it's so much easier to sell a book about Lord, bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, and bracelets that say the prayer of Jabez, books that say the prayer of Jabez, not a lot of bracelets that say come and die. Not a lot of books that sell that say come and die. Much more easier to have a bestseller about Lord, bless me indeed and enlarge my territory. Not wrong, What is wrong, though, is to shift that to a place that it does not belong, and we place so much emphasis on health, wealth, and prosperity, and no emphasis on the idea of dying to self, taking up our cross, and following Jesus. That's the difference. Does he want to bless you? Yes. Does he want health, wealth, prosperity for you? Yes. Does he still ask you to come and die, and maybe those very things he blessed you with need to be given over and submitted to him? Yes. But the true blessing, the sweet spot in our salvation, is choosing to join Christ in his suffering, because in that invitation, you will find life. You will find life that none of those things here on earth give us. Jesus always showed up when he was invited. He was never a leader to turn people away. Religious people, the Roman authorities, children, family members, all had access to Jesus. Jesus never seemed concerned about what he would do with his time. He was a willing servant. And even now in his omnipresence via the Holy Spirit, he is always accessible to every single person. Psalms 145:18 says this, "The Lord is near to all those who call on him, to all those who will call on him in truth," that he is very near and dear. And for many of us, if we're actually choosing to take up our cross and follow him, that should bring great comfort to our soul. Knowing that in our trials, in our tribulations, in the difficulty, that he's always there. That he is always there. But the battle we deal with is one of comfort and discomfort. I don't know about you, but if I'm dealing with comfort or discomfort, I choose comfort every time. I don't like theme park rides. I don't like bungee jumping. I don't like hang gliding. I wasn't even that excited to do the on tree climbing down in Windsor, but my wife wanted to do that for our anniversary. I like comfort. I like being on the ground. I like comfort. But his message never guarantees comfort. Jesus instead actually guarantees trials to his followers. When he says, "In this world, you will have trouble." So he doesn't say, "In this world, you might have trouble. In this world, sometimes you'll have trouble." He just says, "In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world." Discipleship demands sacrifice. Jesus never hid from that. He never hid from the cost of being a disciple. And if I can challenge you with this, if you ever hear the gospel preached, we have access to so many churches now online through YouTube. Everybody's online. Everybody's preaching. But if no one ever challenges you that following Jesus will sometimes mean sacrifice, that following Jesus will sometimes mean stepping out into discomfort, then you need to walk away from that type of teaching. That's not the life he's called us to. He has not called us to a life of comfort. He is the comforter, though. So while you'll step out into discomfort, he's the comforter. While you'll step out into moments where you feel weak, he's the power. And he will go with you in every single thing he asks you to go into. There is nothing he will ask of you that he won't walk with you through. It is life, not death. James 1:12 says, "Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him." Hebrews 2:17 says, "He will be a faithful high priest who understands our struggle." In Luke 9:57 to 62, three different men express a willingness to follow Jesus. And when Jesus asks them a few more questions, they realize that they had not counted the cost. None of them were willing to take up the cross and forsake their own interest for Christ's. It seems clear sometimes when we look at Scripture, it's so easy to look at people who walked a different path than us and judge them. Oh, I can't believe that they do that. You know, it was Jesus Christ, and he's right there in front of them. And, you know, why wouldn't he give up his finance? Why wouldn't they do this? Why wouldn't they do that? I've looked at Israel before and said, why do they keep turning their back on God? What's their problem? Why do they have so little faith? And the more I read the Bible, the more I see myself in the Scripture. Am I willing? Am I willing? Would I follow Jesus if it meant losing my closest friends? Would I follow him if it meant alienation from my family? Would you follow Jesus if it meant the loss of your reputation, losing your job, or in some places around this world, losing your life? Actual death is a real possibility when a person becomes a Christian in some parts of the world, even today. And if you're really tuned into some of the media, that it doesn't make CNN or Fox News or CBC or CTV, there are Christians all over the world that lose their lives for the cause of Christ. And we are blessed to be in a nation where we don't worry about that right now. Taking up our cross and following Christ means commitment to the point where we'd say, I will give up my hopes, dreams, possessions, and my very life if need be, because that's how much Jesus means to me. If we're going to preach a series that says, I am radical, are we willing to say, are we willing to walk in the radical call of Jesus? One that gets us outside of our comfort zone? One that looks difficult? One that actually feels a little bit radical, that feels a little bit extreme, a message that some people would hear maybe and say, that type of Christianity is not for me. Because Jesus never had a moment where he turned the message around and said, well, let me try to convince you why it might be for you. Can I talk you into this? Can I twist your arm a little bit? He said, no, this is what it's going to cost, but I promise you there is life on the other side, not death. I'm going to invite the worship team to come back as we move to a close today. I want to challenge you with the call that I have felt God calling me to in this season. It is not enough to survive in this season. We have all been shaken during this time. I know we've talked about it a lot. It overpowers our conversations, COVID-19, and how much it has changed our lives. He's walked with us. He's led us in this season. He's been our comfort in times of trouble. He's been our provider when there seemed to be no way. And now he comes as we walk into a new season, as we walk into the fall, he comes. And I feel this pull on my own heart personally and says, come and die, take up your cross and follow me. It's not enough to survive in this season. It's not enough to just hold on and say, okay, God, once you get me out of this pandemic, once things stabilize, I will serve you with my whole heart. It's time to say today. Today is the day. Today is the day where I say, God, I recommit to you. And I say, God, whatever it is you have of me, I'm willing to submit it to you. Whatever it is. Whatever it is. No more putting things off because of discomfort. No more walking away from what you've called me to because of discomfort. When Jesus asked this of his followers, here's what's interesting. He had actually already sent them out to herald the gospel. Earlier in the portion of scripture, he had sent them out to preach the gospel message. And then he's telling them, take up your cross and follow me. As a reminder, this isn't about your salvation. Obviously, they had already received Christ and were heralding the gospel, but he was saying there's a next step in your obedience. There's a next step in your sacrifice and submission. And I say this to you, that like Peter, who tradition tells us, and there's some history to back this up, that Peter did not want to be crucified the way Jesus was crucified. He asked to be crucified upside down when he was martyred for his faith. He didn't feel like he was worthy. And I say this, as I put this message together, as I was praying, I said, Lord, I don't feel worthy to even join you in this. This invitation, this one that seems heavy, that will bring me life and joy, I don't feel worthy. And he returns with this response and says, you can take up your cross and follow me because I've already went to the cross for you. And because of my blood, because of the shed blood and the forgiveness of sin, you can join me in the suffering and take up your cross because you are covered. Knowing this, that the joy that awaits the believer in Christ far surpasses any suffering we might be welcoming in. Let me say that again. The joy that awaits the believer in Christ far surpasses any suffering that you welcome in. I want to read you a verse that has stuck with me for a very long time. 2 Corinthians 4:18, it says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, and what is unseen is eternal. We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, and what is unseen is eternal. When we take up our cross, we live for what is unseen, knowing that the life to come is far greater than you can ever imagine. I'm convinced that if you look at the early church, so much of what drove the early church was the soon return of Christ. That was the preaching that I remember growing up under. That Christ is going to return. Christ is coming back. Christ is coming back. Am I living for what's eternal, or am I living for what's now? My next house, my next job, my next promotion, my next paycheck. Or am I willing to say, when he says, take up your cross and follow me, that the cross is not a burden, it's an honor. The cross is not a burden, it's an honor. If you hear this message this morning and you feel like, you know what, I don't know Jesus Christ in that way, but I would like to. This is a contact card that's going to pop up on your screen in a moment. You can reach out to us. We would love to pray with you. But it's very, very simple. If you want to ask Jesus into your heart, all you have to do is extend him the invitation. God, I want you in my life. I repent of my sin. I ask for forgiveness by the blood of Jesus Christ. And I want to serve you and I want to follow you. That's all it takes. It's a simple invitation. It says, he stands at the door and knocks. He doesn't care what's on the other side. He doesn't care what's going on in your life right now. If you heard this message of take up your cross and you said, what's on the other side of my door is not a good place. He doesn't want me. He does want you because he knows what's on the other side of the door, and yet he still desires to come in. He still desires to have you as a son or a daughter. That's who he is. The cross is not a burden. It's an honor. Let me pray for you this morning. Heavenly Father, I thank you for each and every person that's watching this service. God, I ask right now for myself. I repent for times when I've chosen comfort over discomfort. Times when the cross felt heavy, and instead of turning to you to be empowered, I turned to my television or my refrigerator or something else for a power source. Knowing that only you bring power, only you bring love, only you bring life. I repent of that today. And God, I ask for every single person that says, I want to take up my cross and follow him. I want to join him in his suffering. God, that you would give them whatever they need. You will equip, you will direct. And we come into this fall not saying that we're going to be suffocated by a pandemic, but we come into this fall and say, whatever you have for us, I want to serve you, I want to go with you. And I'm willing to go. God, I ask that you would bless them as they go into the rest of their day. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Here I stand, Lord, my life is in your hands. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Not my own. to you I belong. I give myself to you. Yes, Lord, my life is not my own. It's to you I belong. I give myself to you, Lord. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can